And as they leave, and I encourage you to turn to Luke chapter 22. It can be found on page 881 in the Bibles that are provided for you. As you turn there, I don't know if you've ever thought about this. This is one of those questions that I think it's fun to dialogue about, and there's no right or wrong answer. But at what point in biblical history would you like to go back to observe, to experience? I have a couple on my list. Of course, the Garden of Eden, before sin, of course. The plagues in Egypt and how God powerfully led his people out. That time, Mount Sinai, where God has given the law, is just one of my favorite portions of Scripture. I think I'd like to hang out with Daniel, the times when he's interacting with Nebuchadnezzar and the other guys, to listen to one of the prophets of old or one of the apostles preach the day of Pentecost in Acts 2. Anytime, of course, with the life of Christ, the birth announcement, and maybe one of my favorite miracles, the cross resurrection. Maybe as I asked that question, a couple things came to mind, and maybe I mentioned a couple of those things. But I'm gonna guess that what did not make the top of your list is Jesus's this last Passover that he shared with his disciples on the night he was betrayed. But after meditating on this passage the last few weeks, it has climbed dramatically up on my list. Our passage today is one of the most important events in biblical history. It's a meal. It lasted just a few hours, but the significance is literally beyond our comprehension. Jesus gives us these symbols, and we can grab the understanding of that because they're symbols. They're meant to help us understand. And we can feel the effects in our faith and our relationship with God, the joy of forgiveness, the hope of eternal life, for example. But the depth and the wonder is beyond our human understanding in this life. It's beyond my limited and simple vocabulary to express the significance and glory of what Jesus taught his disciples and what he was about to do on the cross. I have to admit, more than any other sermon, this one, as Paul says in 1 Corinthians 2, with fear and trembling. This one, above all the others, fear and trembling. Because of what Christ is teaching his disciples, what it meant for him and for them and for us. So here's the application. To be filled with awe all over again for the glory and the love that Jesus has. To be led to praise with God with thankful hearts. To have a higher view of God's love and glory. As I mentioned, this is an impossible task for me, for us. But Jesus says, what's impossible with man is possible with God. So let's ask him for his help to do just that. Let's pray. Oh Lord, as we do every week, we come before you in your word, unable to comprehend and to understand your truth without your help. And so as Paul prays in Ephesians 3, that he prayed for the church, that they were rooted and established in love. But he prayed that they would comprehend what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge. They would be filled with the fullness of God. So, Lord, we ask that very thing. Help us to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. And we know because we're asking the one who does far beyond what we can ask or think. And so, Lord, we ask that you would help us this morning. Amen. Luke 22, start in verse 7, after I get a drink. Then came the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and prepare the Passover for us, that we may eat it." And they said to him, Where will you have us prepare it? And he said to them, "Behold, when you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him into the house that he enters. And tell the master of the house, 'The teacher says to you, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' And he will show you a large upper room furnished. Prepare it there." And they went and found it just as he told them. And they prepared the Passover. And when the hour came, he reclined at table and the disciples with him. And he said to them, "I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my blood, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, after they had eaten, he said, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the man of him who betrays me is with me on the table. For the Son of Man goes as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed." And they began to question one another which of them it could be who was going to do this. The preparation for the Passover. You remember from last week, the first few verses of chapter 22, we have this scene where different groups of people, the chief priests and the scribes, Pharisees, the Sanhedrin, the Sadducees, Judas himself, even Satan is mentioned that he's involved in this. Those groups, many of whom didn't like each other. In some ways, they were enemies, but they were united together to get rid of their common enemy, Christ, to destroy him. And a series of events, the chief priests and scribes remember that they were planning not to do anything during this time, but an opportunity came, and so they took it. They might have been thinking that they now have the element of surprise. Jesus won't know what hit him. Satan, even in Satan's all his power and craftiness, he was not in control of anything. Maybe Judas influencing. I think in part, Luke tells us these details so that we can be encouraged and have confidence that Christ is in control. See, Jerusalem, during this Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread would have had estimated 200,000 extra people, pilgrims, coming in to town. Obviously, you can visualize that. This is the most anticipated feast, anticipated festival within the Jewish calendar. This may be a really poor illustration, but kind of taking our Thanksgiving and our Christmas and our Easter dinners and throwing in a Super Bowl tailgate party and wrapping that all up into one, and that's what this time is. That's the excitement and the anticipation that Jesus and his disciples are now in. And this is a very special Passover meal, more than any of the others. Preparation for this meal was very practical. Peter and John would have had to go into the city and maybe do some shopping for the other elements of the meal, the herbs and whatnot, the wine, the candles. They would have had to purchase the lamb that was certified by the priests, would have had to wait in line for these mass slaughterings. A couple times throughout the day, they would have these mass slaughterings of the lambs, and then they would take that lamb and take it back to this room that Jesus told them to go to and continue to prepare. That's kind of the practical, physical side, but there's also a spiritual component. They had to, this is probably already done, I'm guessing, but they probably double, triple checked that there was no leaven in that place. Because even way back with Moses, God said to get rid of the leaven. Get rid of, and part of that representation is get rid of the sinfulness. Get rid of it. There would have been some ceremony cleansing of the pots and utensils that would be used, and no doubt in the temple during that sacrifice there, but then also throughout the singing and reciting of several psalms. A lot of reflecting and worship and prayer. They ask, where should we go? And Jesus says, go and do this, you'll find this, follow him, and ask this, and this is what you'll find. And is there anyone surprised that they found it just as he had told them? I don't see any hands. It's not a coincidence. Some think that Jesus just knew this because he's God, and that's fine. I kind of think he made arrangements beforehand. That doesn't mean that I'm, I lack faith or minimizing Jesus in any way. It just makes sense to me. Jesus knew what Judas and the others were up to. They were looking for a time where he was not with the crowds that they could get to Jesus and deal with him, get rid of him. This would have been a good time to do that because everyone else was busy doing their own Passover. I think Jesus made arrangements beforehand and only tells Peter and John so that Judas doesn't know. Because what we'll look at in a moment, he wanted to, in fact, he needed to have this Passover with his disciples. And nothing and no one was going to delay it or to speed it up or to keep it from happening altogether. That's why I think Jesus made arrangements beforehand. But it doesn't matter. The end result is that he's in complete control. John Piper says this about providence. He says, providence is the all-embracing, all-pervasive, invincible, purposeful sovereignty of God. And if you didn't get that, neither did I. But John Piper has a book, 700 or so pages worth, it unpacks that. But thankfully, on one of those pages, he simplifies it for me and says this: God sees to it that things happen in a certain way. Thank you, Pastor Piper, because I needed that. God sees to it that all things happen in a certain way according to his will. So as amazing as it is that Jesus said to Peter and John, go and you'll find this, and they found it, what is infinitely more amazing and awe-inspiring is what Jesus is now going to teach to his disciples. There is a greater exodus to come. And Jesus wants to explain that and teach them this. He earnestly, verse 15, he earnestly desires to eat this Passover. He desires so much to have this moment with them. Why does Jesus want to? I think there's three reasons. He wants to teach them. He wants to teach them what this Passover, this, I'll say, new meaning of the Passover is all about. It's pointing to what he's about to accomplish before, he says, before I suffer. Of course, he's looking at the cross. Jesus is that Passover lamb, the fulfillment of all that the Old Testament looks forward to. He is that Messiah. They know it. And he's going to give them another teachable moment that confirms that. Secondly, Luke tells us, and the apostles were with him. Luke doesn't throw that word apostle around. It's like five or six times in all of the Gospel of Luke. He uses that. But these men are the ones who are going to go tell the world that he's the Messiah. So part of that teaching, and part of the reason why I think he wants to tell them and teach them, is because now they're going to go and teach others. But maybe above all, it's because he loves them. In fact, all that he has done is out of his infinite love. All the healings, all the teachings, all the compassion, all the times when he stopped and loved somebody, healed them, taught them. All the displays of power and glory. Even the washing of their feet that John tells us about. And ultimately dying for them, for us on the cross. During this upper room time, Jesus would have said what John records in John 15, that greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. And Paul tells us that God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He earnestly wanted to have this Passover, I think, because the writer of Hebrews says, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. That joy of being with the ones he loves and for those whom he gave himself up for all of eternity. And that's why Jesus wanted to share this Passover with them. But I think we can kind of boil down three truths that Jesus was teaching them that should eventually would have rocked their world. They would have been filled with awe and unshakable hope. The first we find in verse 15 through 18, there's hope of eternal kingdom through Christ. Two times Jesus mentions the fulfillment of the coming of the kingdom. Jesus, I think, is looking through the cross, through his resurrection, to that new heavens and new earth. Until it is fulfilled, until the kingdom comes, until its consummation. He takes the cup, and this is a cup in the middle of the Passover meal, the cup of thanksgiving. Thanksgiving, presumably for the work of salvation, God's deliverance. Maybe Jesus had in mind this scene in heaven from Revelation 5, where there's the hosts of heaven are crying out in a new song, "Worthy are you," talking of Christ, "worthy are you to take this scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you've ransomed people for God, from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you've made them a kingdom and a priest to our God, and they shall reign on earth." Or maybe, as many scholars think, Jesus may have even been, and we read this earlier in our service, that scene where the marriage supper of the Lamb, "Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and exalt and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and the bride has made herself ready. It is granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, pure, bright and pure. And then the angel tells John, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And whether Jesus had those things in mind or not, we don't know. But I think what he's doing there and what Luke has recorded for us through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit is to give the disciples and to give us hope. Their world was going to get very, very, very difficult in a very short amount of time. If they had nearsightedness and couldn't see that hope that Jesus is talking about, they would have failed. And so would we. But I think Luke and the Lord has given us this hope because there is a greater kingdom to come. It's greater because he's a greater king. He's the one that's sitting on the throne. It's greater because of the length of this kingdom. It's eternal. It's greater in power. It's power over sin and death and hell. It's a greater kingdom because of its purity. It's without sin and its effects. When the new heavens and new earth come, he, God, will wipe away every tear from our eyes. And death shall be no more, and there shall be neither shall there be mourning or crying or pain, for the former things have passed. It's complete. Everything and all of creation is now restored. It's greater because of the intimacy. For God says that I will be their God and they will be my people. We will see each other face to face. Jesus desires to have this Passover and to teach them and give them hope of a future kingdom. And it's only made possible for what he was about to accomplish on the cross. I don't know about you, but that is unshakable hope. When Christ himself says, I'm not going to eat of this until the kingdom comes, he's going to eat. Whatever he meant by that, he's going to do it. That is hope for them. It is hope for us. Blessed are those who were invited to eat with him. The next truth, I think Jesus shares with them so that they could be filled with awe and hope. We find in verses 19 and 20, the new covenant is established through the blood of Jesus. Jesus kind of redefines, if you will, the Passover. And this is not to dismiss or to eliminate the old covenant, but he's fulfilling it. It's as if the first Passover is fading away and this new Lord's Supper and all of its significance is kind of coming into clearer, sharper view. And see, in the first Passover, Exodus 12, it was supposed to be a memorial feast for all of Israel's generations. They were to look back and to remember, like we are to look back when we celebrate the Lord's Supper. And when the children ask, what does all this mean? They are to say it is a sacrifice of the Lord's Passover. For he passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians and spared our houses. It was a symbol to remember God's mercy and his power. Augustine is credited with a quote, and he's talking about both baptism and the Lord's Supper. But the sign, those signs are a visible display pointing to a reality different from and more significant than itself. It's a visible display pointing to a reality different from and more significant than itself. And that certainly applies to the Passover too. You see, many of the elements of worship and spiritual life in the Old Testament were a foreshadow. The writer of Hebrews says that they're a shadow of the reality of things to come. That Christ himself has fulfilled those. He's the better high priest. He's the better holy place by which we can enter through. He's the better atoning sacrifice and so on. he himself fulfills what was anticipated or foreshadowed in the Old Testament with a greater deliverance, a greater exodus, a greater effect and effectiveness. And see, the first Passover in Exodus 11, God tells Moses, who then goes and tells Pharaoh, there's going to be one more plague, the death of the firstborn. From the highest, from the greatest to the least, and oh yeah, even the livestock. Every firstborn is going to die in the land of Egypt. Where were the Hebrews? In the land of Egypt. How are they going to be rescued? How are they going to be spared? Well, it's through trusting and obeying God's instructions. And if they didn't believe and act upon that belief, then they were going to die. Of all the Passover instructions, I want to focus in on that which is, surrounds the lamb. They were to take a lamb, from one for every household. A male lamb, a one-year-old, and without blemish. They were to bring this lamb into their house on the 10th day, and on the 14th day they were to slaughter it, roast it, and then eat it that night. And if there was anything left over, they were supposed to burn it. And the focal point, the central to that sacrifice of the lamb, was the blood. They were to sacrifice this lamb and to take some of the blood and put it on the lintels and the doorposts. And there would have been a basin at the threshold of their home to catch water and things, or in this case, catch some blood. So the whole entrance to where they were staying was covered in blood. And God says to Moses, "For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and in all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt." God was coming to give judgment upon the land, to show that he and he alone is God. He was bringing judgment. But here we see this wonderful picture of salvation, of God's grace and his mercy. God said, "All the firstborn I'm going to kill. But there's a way of escape." The judgment upon the Egyptians is obvious. The judgment is also upon the lamb as that substitute, so that the people of Israel could go free, could be spared. See, God would pass over those who believed and obeyed him, and they would not be destroyed. I think it's interesting that God says, "This is, the blood will be a sign for you." As you're in there, and God's judgment is happening, am I going to be okay? All the blood. I believed what God said, and I followed through, and we're going to be okay. Hang on, kids. But when God passed through, he saw the blood. The payment was made. So he moved on. See, a death had to happen. A death occurred. A sacrificial payment was made. See, God's judgment was coming. And this was the only way that they could be saved. Again, the focus is on what God did on behalf of his people. What God promised, he was seen so that it happened. So what is Jesus saying about himself in this Passover lamb? Again, it's a visual representation of their salvation. This Passover, a past deliverance. Jesus changes that and he says, now focus on what I'm about to do for you. To bring deliverance, to bring salvation, to redeem you. In verse 19, he says, this is my body. Talking about the bread, that unleavened bread. And there's a lot more to be said here, but I just want, this is the sinless, without any evil, that point, right? Christ is sinless. He was that spotless lamb. It is broken, signifying his death, that violent death. He said, this is my body given for you, substituted instead of you. His righteousness is imputed and credited to the one who believes by faith. So that his sinless, righteous life is then applied to our account before God. And his death is that payment. As if Jesus is saying here, take my righteousness as your own. And I will take all of your sin guilt and I will bear the full weight of it before God. And I will die for you instead of you. This is, he says, my body given for you, like the Passover lamb was. Verse 20, he takes this cup and says, this cup is poured out for you. It's a new covenant in my blood. This, in the Old Testament, blood would have been thrown or poured out all over the altar. The Passover lamb that was slain that first Exodus would have been a gruesome sight. It would have been a lot of blood poured out, gushed out. And Jesus is saying, now I'm being poured out. I'm being offered on that altar. Again, for you. It is a new covenant in my blood. A new covenant, a sign, again, pointing to the reality that's more significant than itself. The prophet Jeremiah, about 600 years earlier, says this. He said, behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. And a little bit later, Jeremiah says this. God says this through Jeremiah. For I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more. It's a greater exodus. The writer of Hebrews says this in talking about the Old Testament sacrifices in Christ and comparing the two. He says, every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sin. But when Christ had offered for all time, including those of the first Passover, a single sacrifice for sin, he sat down at the right hand of God, awaiting from that time until his enemy should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who were being sanctified. The writer of Hebrews also says that Jesus has become the greater guarantee of a better covenant. This is a monumental, redemptive history changing moment. It's ushering in a new era. And just a few hours from this meal, Jesus would die. His blood would be shed, poured out, so that others may be spared. And when God looks upon the one who has faith in Jesus as that lamb, he sees his blood. and passes over. God's judgment and his salvation meet in a very mighty display of his love and his sovereignty. The final truth I think Jesus is communicating with his disciples here is that God the Father is determined to provide salvation through the Son. This is God's eternal plan to redeem his people. The Son of Man is going to go as it has been determined. The sovereign God was orchestrating every single detail, from the guy who's carrying water to the exact timing, the exact year, the exact way in which the Messiah was going to die. And he had promised, and he had gave us hints and clues way long time ago, for millennia. He didn't forget. He wasn't delayed. He's not limited or overpowered. He's always in complete control. He has seen to it that things happen in a certain way. But woe to the man who rejects the Messiah, who does not believe that the blood can save. Just like in Egypt on that first Exodus, the first Passover, if they didn't trust God's word, if they didn't have faith, if they thought God had fallen off his rocker, I mean, the throne doesn't have a rocker. If they didn't believe God, they would have died in their sin. So it is now. It is by faith in Christ's shed blood only that we're delivered from certain eternal death. Do you believe that? Nate asked us that question as we began our worship service this morning. Do you believe that? If you do, and maybe you've believed that for decades, I hope, and my words so mightily failed, but I hope you're filled with awe. All over again. At the immeasurable love of Christ. That as we look back to the cross and to the resurrection, that we can have encouragement. We can be filled with hope and know that we have peace through the Son with the Father. And as we look forward, we can look forward to the eternal hope and glory of the kingdom, no matter what this world may bring upon us. We too need to see the blood of Christ and remember that we belong to him. And he will keep us. He will continue to refine us and grow us and shape us, because he always brings about what he sets out to accomplish. Let's pray. Father, oh, the depths of your infinite love and mercy. Father, we are indebted to you to help us see you and your love for us in a greater way. So, Lord, I pray that you would do that in us, do the impossible in us, and help us to understand your great love for us more. And help us to be faithful servants of you as we grow in our fear of you. Amen.
If you have questions about what you've just heard, or if you want to know more about what it means to follow Jesus Christ, I want to encourage you to check out our website, faithbfc.org. If you live in the Harleysville area and you're not part of a local church, we'd love to have you worship with us here at Faith. I look forward to meeting with you personally. But whether you live here or somewhere else, the important thing is to get plugged into a local church where you can grow in your walk with Jesus Christ and help others grow as you serve Him.